This year's Man Booker Prize-winning novel by Marlon James, A History of Seven Killings, starts with a murder attempt on the reggae superstar Bob Marley.
If you know your history, then you would know where you're coming from.
Before I spill the beans any further, let me introduce you to Bindu Amat, who will gracefully take you on a guided tour of Jamaica, the Rastafarian movement, Bob Marley, and all the jazz which makes this Marlon James novel so very compelling. Bindu Amat, an associate professor of English at Providence Women's College, loves baking cakes, the apple cake being her masterpiece. She can also grill you with rapid-fire questions, as she's a no-mean quiz master, mind you. She's passionate about honing the communication skills of her students and loves to involve herself in women's issues. May I now turn to Professor Bindu Amat and request her to unravel the mystery behind A History of Seven Killings?
The work that won the Man Booker Prize for the year 2015 comes with a cover that takes us back to a world that we tend to see as rather obsolete and outdated. The image of the LP record on which the title is printed, in fact, does more than transport us to the 1960s and 70s. It unwinds and plays for us endless stories from that era, stories that continue to resonate in the present over and over again, exactly like those gramophone records of yore. It did not take very long for the jury of the Man Booker Prize to select the Jamaican writer Marlon James as the winner of this year. The brevity of time taken to arrive at that decision, however, is probably the only brief aspect one can associate with a brief history of seven killings. Everything else about it is huge. It is a saga spread over three decades, dished out in about 700 pages, narrated by multiple voices from a cast of 76 characters, rendered in a host of tones and tongues, ranging from slang to the solemn, Jamaican patois to biblical sermons, and pop songs to journalese. Little wonder, then, that the jury summed up the novel as one that is full of surprises, very violent, and full of meaning. The annual announcement of major awards like the Nobel Literature Prize and the Man Booker Prize ensure global recognition for the winners and a consequent spurt in the demand for their books. Many an unheard name has thus achieved fame, generating alongside interest and curiosity among readers in the history and culture of the regions that the laureates hail from. The case of Marlon James is no different. The success of his earlier works, John Crowe's Devil and The Book of the Night Women notwithstanding, a brief history has catapulted him into the realm of sought-after writers and renewed interest in his country's history in a manner that even the iconic Jamaicans like Bob Marley and Usain Bolt have not generated. And that, precisely, is the most remarkable feature of this novel. The first Jamaican writer to win the Booker leads us into the pages of Jamaican history in a way that only someone who has lived through it can. The chronicler here is a native who unfolds for us hidden leaves of the country's past, unseen and therefore untouched by an Anglophile sensibility or a Eurocentric vision or the perspective of any other vested interest. It is not a history that can be reduced to a unidimensional monolith. It is complex and multiple. It is this plurality that gives the novel its gushing impact on the readers. The novel is divided into five sections, each centered around tumultuous events of Jamaican history in the 20th century, with each chapter narrated by different narrators from different realms. The novel offers us a comprehensive view of Jamaica of the 1970s, 80s, and 90s through multiple perspectives, rejecting the monological convention of crafting the novel around a single protagonist. Marlon James accommodates the action as unfolding around several characters. It begins, however, with a fictionalized account of a real event, an event of almost mythic proportions in Jamaica, the attempted murder on the 3rd of December 1976 of the Rastafarian reggae singer Bob Marley, presented in the novel as the singer.
Get up, stand up, stand up for your life. Get up, stand up.
It is well known that this attempt on Marley's life was directly linked to an event slotted to take place just a couple of days later. This was a Smile Jamaica concert aimed at uniting a country that was caught in the violent tussle for power between Edward Siega's conservative Jamaican Labour Party and the People's National Party, led by Michael Manley. It is equally well known that Bob Marley did perform at the concert 2 days later, and that the very next day he left Jamaica for England, not to return for 2 whole years. What is not so well known, however, is what happens to the 7 members of the gang that attacked the Marleys. These are the threads that Marlon James picks up, tracing the killings of these gangsters, leading us through the dark and explosive lanes and alleys of the ghettos and the underground havens called Copenhagen City, and the 8 lanes with their respective Dons, Papa Lo and Josie Wales of the Storm Posse, and Shota Sheriff. With a montage of violent episodes, surreal scenes of crime, poverty, intrigue and sex, the novel exposes the gory ugliness of Kingston's slums. Determined not to silence the authentic voices of this macabre world, James captures the true identity of the land in the vernacular, retaining the patois to a vibrant effect. He then expands the scope of the story beyond these local episodes, highlighting the effect of the Cold War on Jamaica, exposing the interest of the superpowers in Jamaica and its 2 prominent political parties. He further shifts the action to the United States of America, focusing particularly on the cities of New York and Miami and the crack wars of the 80s and 90s, and the consequent impact of these on Jamaica at the turn of the century. These stories come to us sometimes through the writings of the American journalist Alex Pierce, sometimes through the CIA personnel like Barry DeFlorio, women characters like Nina Burgess, drug dealers, and even the ghostly voice of the deceased politician Sir Arthur Jennings. The novel thus leaves us with a polyphonic note, accomplishing Marlon James's intention to raise Jamaica from a reductive picture of a land merely of plantations and ghettos. It succeeds in revealing the complexity of the postcolonial era that we live in. The postcolonial era not just in Jamaica, but in the rest of the world, and shedding light on the network of power and politics in today's globalized world. In an age threatened by totalizing tendencies, the choral notes that emanate from the cacophony of voices in this novel and its pulsating plurality, its dialogism and heteroglossia, hold much relevance and promise for the future of our world. The book exhorts us, I would say, to look forward to a world that facilitates a symphony of voices. A world where there are no margins or centers. A world where Bob Marley himself would have sung, "O soulful town, soulful people, I see you having fun dancing to the reggae rhythm. O island in the sun, smile. Come on and smile.
Buffalo soldier, dread like a rasta. It was a buffalo soldier in the heart of America. Stolen from Africa, brought to America. Fighting an arrival, fighting for survival. I mean it, when I analyze the sin, to me it makes a lot of sense. Yeah.